Welcome. All right, so let's start with a prayer. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of thy faith. Kindle them the fire of thy love. Send forth thy spirit, and they shall be created. And thou shalt renew the face of the earth. Let us pray. God, who instructed the hearts of the faithful by the light of the Holy Spirit, grant us by that same spirit to be truly wise and never to rejoice in his consolation. Through Christ our Lord. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Our Lady, Seat of Wisdom, pray for us. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So welcome, all of you. So our topic today, so we're continuing this series on the sacraments, and it'll be 18 talks altogether on the sacraments. And this is will be part of a book that will come out with the Mayus Academic, so just to mention that, and with the same title, Touched by Christ, and the Sacramental Economy. And so our talk today is on the matter and form of the sacraments. And so this topic is rather straightforward. It has to do with what's visible in the sacraments. And so all the sacraments have a visible part, which is what we see in here, and then they give invisible grace. And so what's difficult in speaking about the sacraments is the invisible part, and what's easier is to speak about what's visible and audible, and that's what we're going to focus on today. But the two go together, because the key principle of all the sacraments is that what you see and hear tells us, shows us, what actually happens invisibly, right? And so the sign value of the sacraments is inseparable from its invisible and life-giving power, right? And so what you see is what you get, unless we pose an obstacle, or what maybe better, what we see and hear is what actually we receive. So all the sacraments. And this is the fundamental law of the sacramental economy, or the sacramental system that Jesus instituted, right? That they signify what they do, and they do what they signify. And so they're sacred signs, but they have a power that transcends their nature as a sign. Right? They're marvelous signs. They're, we could say, divine signs, because they're instituted by Jesus Christ, and so that they do what they signify. But therefore, that means that we need to know what they signify so we can know what they do. And so they have a beautiful symbolism that we're going to look at in this talk. Right? So they're words and signs endowed with power, right? Jesus' power, because creation obeys Jesus, right? And so creation, therefore, and even grace obeys Jesus. And thus what they say is what they do. And so their outward sign value is, we could say, the humblest aspect of the sacraments, but it's the foundation on which everything else is built, because that's what they do. Now the sign value, so we're going to look at that today. The sign value of the sacraments, we could say, draws on three fundamental sources. Creation, first and foremost, right? So something like baptism, making use of water. And so it's drawing on a symbolism that God put into creation itself at the very beginning. And so we'll look at the sign value, the symbolism of water in a few minutes. But it also draws on general human culture, right? So think of the Eucharist, in which the matter is bread and wine. And so that's from creation, but it also involves human work and human culture, taking the two most basic forms of food and drink, or maybe wine is not the most basic, but in many ways the most beautiful form of drink. And then the third is history. So the sacraments are instituted by Jesus for human beings who live in history and in particular, salvation history. And so Jesus instituted the sacraments with the sign value that was made known in Israel through the culture of Israel and God's working in salvation history. And then most particularly, Jesus' own history, his paschal mystery, right? His passion, death, and resurrection and ascension. And so the sacraments also symbolize the history of Israel and the history of Jesus, and in particular, his paschal mystery. Right? So we could say those would be the three fundamental sources for the signs used in the sacraments. And then the last thing that they symbolize is the invisible grace that they give. And so the sacraments draw from creation, draw from culture, draw from salvation history, but they also represent the grace that they give and the sanctification. Right? Now, the sign in each of the sacraments has two parts. And theologians here make a comparison with Aristotle's theory of the composition of matter and form in all physical things. Right? So take us. We've got a physical matter that makes up our body, but a form that makes us human beings, and that's actually our soul that animates us. And then in everything else, likewise, there's a matter that's kind of the raw material, the substrate, and then a form that makes it this rather than something else. And so theologians use this analogy of matter and form to speak about the sacramental sign. So in the sacramental sign, there's a part of it that we could speak of as matter and another part that we speak of as the form, which determines more concretely. Yeah, so as form determines the indeterminate matter of physical bodies, so in the sacraments, there's a formula of words that would be the spoken prayer that would be what we call the sacramental form, right? The form of words. And that's what tells us the exact meaning of the sacramental sign. So take baptism. The matter will be the water, right? But the form will be the words, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So those, we could say that's the or take the Eucharist. The matter will be the bread and the wine that we start with. And then the form is going to be the words of Jesus. This is my body given for you. This is the chalice of my blood. Right, so matter and form. Now, in addition to matter and form, there are two other parts, we could say, of the sacramental sign that maybe we don't think of at first. And that is the subject who receives them and the minister who dispenses them, usually the priest, deacon, or bishop. And so the minister is part of the sign, but we're going to save that for next our next lecture in 2 weeks from now. We'll look at the minister and the subject and how the minister contributes to the sign, sometimes in a very basic way, for example, in the priesthood, by male gender, or in marriage by male and female. And so we're gonna look at that next, in 2 weeks from now, in our next talk, the more controversial issues of why male gender for the priesthood and why complementarity of sex for marriage. But today we're gonna focus on the matter and form. Now to make up the sacramental sign, you need all four of those elements to be right. And that's what makes a sacrament valid. You need the right matter, the right form, the right minister, and the right subject. So let's take the Eucharist. And the right matter would be the bread and the wine. And the right form would be the words of Jesus in the consecration. The right minister would be a priest or bishop. And then the right subject, baptized faithful, who, in order to be fruitful, are already in a state of grace. So that would be an example. Now, in addition to those four elements that we could say make up the nucleus of every sacrament, there's a whole series of prayers that surround that nucleus. And those prayers are added by the church over time. And that's what most develops during the life of the church, right? And that's what exists in different liturgical rites, right? So there's the Latin rite clothed with certain prayers in Latin originally and now in the vernacular, or the Greek rite, etc., Coptic rite. Right? So that what changes there is those prayers that surround that essential nucleus instituted by Jesus Christ. Right? And so we could say in all the sacraments, there's a part instituted by Jesus, which is the nucleus, and then all of that which surrounds it and gives it beauty and solemnity and further meaning, and that's from the church, and that grows and develops over time. Right? And as the church changes that in the past, so she can change it in the future. So let's look now more closely at the matter and the form. And so the matter is material elements, right? So baptism, water, in the Eucharist, bread and wine, but also gestures. And so it's not just water in baptism, but it's the water has to be applied, right? So you don't get a baptism if there's just a baptismal font and you say the right words, but the water never touches the person. So part of the matter in baptism is the pouring or the immersion into the water. So that would be the gesture. Or let's take confirmation. The matter there is the chrism, olive oil with balsam mixed with it to give that beautiful odor of Christ. But it has to be applied, right? And so it's applied to the forehead in the sign of a cross. Right? And so that would be the gesture there. And similar in anointing of the sick. And in the case of ordination, it's going to be the laying on of hands. And so that's the matter is precisely that gesture of laying on of hands and confirmation. Yeah. That's part of the sign in confirmation as well. All right. And then the form are the words that make explicit the meaning of the gesture and the matter. Now, this comparison of matter and form to the sacraments is expressed very beautifully by St. Augustine, speaking of baptism. He says, take away the word, and the water is neither more nor less than water. The word is added to the element, and there results the sacrament, as if itself also a kind of visible word. Right? In other words, the whole sacrament combined of matter and form, in other words, of matter and the words, the whole thing makes a kind of visible, audible word. That's what a sacrament is. A beautiful way of thinking about it. Every sacrament is like a sensible word said by Jesus Christ through a minister that makes Jesus's power to sanctify present wherever that word it sounds today. Right? So it's a kind of visible word. And then St. Augustine asks, where does water have so great a power as in touching the body to cleanse the soul, save by the operation of the word? And we might say, well, why? How can a word have so much power? And we'd want to ask, whose word is it? Jesus's word. I don't know. His word has the same power today as it did 2,000 years ago when he said to the leper, be healed, or to the paralytic, and rise and take up your bed and walk. And then we also, that word has that power also because it's received in faith. And that's what makes it fruitful in us. Another example of this analogy is from the letter to the Ephesians, St. Paul, chapter 5, verse 26, text read at weddings. Christ gave himself up for his church, his bride, quote, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word. Right? So that's a beautiful description of baptism right there. Washing of water with the word. And again, a word of power, the word of Jesus. And the whole thing together, both the washing and the word together, make this visible word of power that does what it expresses, what it symbolizes. Saint Irenaeus in the second century, one of the maybe the first great systematic theologian in the life of the church, he speaks about the Eucharist in his Against the Heresies. And he says that the Eucharist is made when the manufactured bread receives the word of God. Right? So when in the offertory, when we bring up the gift of the bread and wine and put them on the altar, it's bread. But when that bread receives the word, which, and whose word is it? The word of Christ, the word from the Last Supper, this is my body, right? The bread receives that word of God and becomes what the word says, body of Christ, and makes us into what the word says, a member of his body, part of the body of Christ. So we could think of it, the two parts to the sacrament, the matter being kind of the receptive part and the word being the active part. Right? And the active because it's Jesus's word. Now this distinction of matter and form works well for five of the sacraments. Right? It works the best for baptism and the Eucharist and confirmation. And so there we've got water, bread and wine, olive oil, and likewise anointing the sick, olive oil. Ordination, it works, but not quite as well because there's the only matter there is the hands that are laid on. So it's living matter, as it were. It's really just a gesture. But then in two of the sacraments, it doesn't work so well because there's no matter at all, at least visible matter. And that is confession and marriage, right? Holy matrimony. And in those two cases, we still, theologians still speak of matter and form, but it's a little more complicated because what the matter is there is actually a human action. And in the case of confession, the matter is what we do as penitents, and that is our confession and our act of contrition, and then the act of satisfaction that we're given. Right? So that in the sacrament of confession, we can still speak of the matter of the sacrament, but it's what we bring to the sacrament in order to eliminate, and that is our sins that we confess and our contrition that receives the absolution. And so there too, you still have matter and form. What we bring, the confession, the humble confession of sins, and what Jesus brings, his word of forgiveness and absolution. And the two together make the sacrament of penance or confession. In the case of matrimony, the matter and the form is one and the same, and it is the words that express consent, right? The consent to the I do, right? That's what makes marriage, the marital vow. And we'll come back to that. So St. Thomas explains this difference in the sacraments, that some of them have this physical matter, water and baptism, bread and wine, olive oil, and others don't. And he compares it to two different kinds of remedy a doctor might prescribe, right? So you go to a doctor, hopefully you don't have to, but sometimes we do, and he might give us something like a pill, an ointment, a bandage, a surgery, some kind of a chiropractor giving some kind of therapeutic massage. And so all of those we could compare. So the pill would be like the Eucharist, taking bread and wine. The bandage might be like, the therapeutic massage, like the laying on of hands in holy orders. But a doctor might also prescribe a diet. That would be more like the Eucharist, I guess. Or exercise. So that exercise that the doctor prescribes would be something that I do. And that's how we should think of penance and matrimony, that the matter is what we do. And it, in the case of confession, the confession of sins with contrition and our willingness to make satisfaction. And in the case of marriage, the act of marital consent, I do. All right, so five of the sacraments use an exterior matter. But two of them, penance and matrimony, make use of the human acts of the recipient as its matter. And then the reason for this, the reason why these two are different, is because in those two sacraments, Jesus didn't institute something totally new. He took, right? So marriage existed from the beginning, Genesis 2, the two shall be one flesh. So marriage existed from creation. And so Jesus didn't make something new. What he did was he gave to what already existed from the beginning a new power to represent his union with his bride, the church, and a new power to sanctify coming from his paschal mystery. And similarly, in the sacrament of confession, that too isn't something new, because ever since the beginning of time, or rather, let's say, ever since the fall, when there have been sins in the world, it's been part of natural law, the law written on the heart, that we should apologize to God and to tell him that we're sorry, and thus to do penance as a kind of virtue, apologizing, confessing to God, and promising reform and seeking to make amends. And so there too, Jesus didn't institute something new. What he did is he gave a new power to what was written on the heart from the beginning, and he gave a way in which we do that by confessing to his ministers, confessing to him through his ministers, and hearing his voice through them saying the words of absolution. So in both of those cases, penance and the sacrament of matrimony, Jesus took something already existing from the fall, in the case of matrimony, from creation, and gave it a new power to work through him and to represent him. And so that's why in those two cases, there's not a new matter. It's a human act that already existed that Jesus is empowering and elevating. So this distinction between matter and form is part of the magisterium of the church. So the Council of Florence speaks about this in its decree for the Armenians. And it says, all of these sacraments are accomplished by three elements: the things as the matter, the words as the form, and the person of the minister who confers the sacrament with the intention of doing what the church does. And we'll talk more about that in 2 weeks. In fact, we'll talk a lot about what does that mean, that so the minister has to have a right intention, and that is to celebrate Mass and not to do something else. And likewise, the recipient has to intend to receive the sacrament if he's capable. We'll look at that in 2 weeks from now. And if any of these are absent, the sacrament is not accomplished, or in other words, is invalid. In order for a sacrament to be valid, you need to have the right matter, the right form, the right minister with the right intention to do what the church does. And then Florence didn't mention it, but we could add in the right subject. And in the case of baptism, that's any human being, but they have to intend to receive it if they're at the age of reason. And for the other sacraments, the condition is that they be baptized and intend, etc. And we'll look at that in 2 weeks from now. Council of Trent likewise speaks of matter and form in its, the Catechism of the Council of Trent. So after the Council of Trent in the 16th century, the church put out a new catechism, which was, I think, its first universal catechism. And it's a masterpiece, the Catechism of the Council of Trent. And it also goes by the title, the Roman Catechism. So I've taken a lot of things from that. After the Second Vatican Council, maybe its greatest fruit, we have a new catechism, the Catechism of the Catholic Church. And so those are the two universal catechisms. And the more recent one doesn't invalidate the previous one, right? But we can draw from both. And so one of the things that the Catechism of the Council of Trent highlights is matter and form. It says two things that make up every sacrament. The first has the nature of matter, called the element. The second has the nature of form and is called the word. And it comes from St. Augustine. Had the word to the element, and we get the sacrament. And the reason why words are added is because the gesture or the matter can be ambiguous, can signify more than one thing. So take water. Water can signify many things, but the words tell us more precisely the meaning. Or bread and wine can signify many things, but the words tell us Christ's body and Christ's blood. And so the words of the two, the words are more important because they express the meaning more exactly. And for this reason, you need to have the words that express that meaning. And so if a minister changes them radically, you would lose the form and the sacrament would be invalid. If we have time at the end, we can say some more about that. Right, and so that would render the sacrament null. But the same thing is true for the matter, right? So if you don't have the right matter, the sacrament will be void or invalid. As we'll see in a few minutes. Leo XIII, at the end of the 19th century, he gave an apostolic letter in which he determined infallibly that the Anglican Church had lost valid holy orders. And in the course of this apostolic letter, he speaks about the nature of the sacraments and also speaks about matter and form. And he says, all know that in the sacraments of the new law, inasmuch as they are sensible and efficacious signs of invisible grace, they must both signify the grace that they affect and affect the grace that they signify. Right? That's how the sacraments work. And therefore, even if the signification must be found in the whole, in the matter and form together, nevertheless, it pertains in a special way to the form, since the matter is the part not determined, but determined by the form. And he says, in the sacrament of holy orders, this is even more true, and that's because in the sacrament of holy orders, the matter is the laying on of hands, which also happens in confirmation, and is a common human symbol that could mean different things. For example, it's given in the ordination of a deacon, priest, and bishop. And so it's gotta be the words that are the significant thing to say what you're being ordained for, right? Whether you're being confirmed or ordained a deacon or a priest or a bishop. And so the words are the, you could say, the completing thing. And you can see from this, if there's a change in the words that's significant that would change the meaning, that will make the sacrament invalid. And Leo XIII says that's what happened in the Anglican Church in the 16th century. And that's how they lost the sacrament of holy orders. We'll come back to this if we have time at the end. Right? And the reason for that was that in the mid 16th century, they changed the rite of ordination in the Anglican Church, keeping laying out of hands and the words receive the Holy Spirit, but taking away any reference to priesthood and the offering of the sacrifice of the Mass. And the reason why they took that away is because, influenced by Calvinism, they saw the Mass, they denied that the Mass was a sacrifice. And therefore, the idea of a priest is one who offers sacrifice. And so that's the reason why the rite of ordination was changed and thus rendered invalid the beginning of the 16th century, or the middle of it. Okay. All right, so let's look now at the matter. So this is the easier part, and the different dimensions of the symbolism. And so we'll start with baptism. And so, as we said before, right, so that we've got creation, we've got culture, we've got history. And so in the dimension of creation, water washes. And so that's the most obvious thing. And therefore, it signifies that in baptism, there's a washing taking place, a spiritual washing. Bread and wine nourish. That signifies that there's a spiritual nourishment taking place. Oil comforts, heals, beautifies. And thus, there's a spiritual comforting, healing, strengthening, and beautifying. Laying on of hands is a natural symbol of headship, right? Especially if you're laying hands on someone's head, right? It's the idea of transferring the headship from one person to another person, and therefore a transferring of the power of headship, right? And that's why that's the natural sign used in holy orders, but also confirmation, right? Because there's a transfer of headship, as we'll see. That would be the level of creation. And then the other levels are history, we said, the Paschal Mystery, and a reference to the Jewish rites that prefigure the Christian sacraments. And then the sign also signifies our reception of grace. So, for example, being washed, receiving into our bodies Christ's body and blood through the species of bread and wine. Our being anointed, our having hands laid on us. So all of this, so maybe I've made this too complicated, but in all of the symbolism of the sacraments, there's an analogy, and it's the analogy between nature and grace. And so something is done on the level of nature to signify and effect something on the level of grace. And so baptism, again, the easiest, baptismal washing brings about spiritual cleansing. And so something happens on the natural order to signify and realize something on the supernatural order. And so just as we enter natural life through birth, so we enter the spiritual life through the sacrament of rebirth, baptism. So that would be a second meaning there. Water being associated with, not with washing there, but with life. And thus a new life and a new birth. And so as A is to B, that would be as water is to washing, so A prime, spiritual, in other words, sacramental water is to a sacramental washing, which washes the spirit. As physical birth, water plays a part in physical birth, so it plays a part in spiritual birth. Right? And so it's the analogy between the order of nature and the order of grace. And that's maybe we could say the most fundamental. Jesus wants to communicate his divine life. So this is the interchange. Jesus takes on our visible, sensible life. He takes on what is ours to give us what is his. But what is his is invisible to us. And so he gives us what is his, which is invisible, through sensible things so that we can receive the divine life in a way fitting for us sensible bodily beings. So that's the basic principle. So let's start with baptism. And so the key thing here is that there's more than one meaning. Again, what we should expect. Even though the sacraments are so simple, they are deceptively simple that they contain more meaning than we see at first sight. So I think most people are aware of one part of the meaning, but not so aware of another part of that symbolism. So in the case of baptism, the most obvious meaning is washing. And so as water washes the body, so the water of baptism washes the soul. And thus washes away what makes us stained. And what makes us stained is sin. And that's of two kinds, original and personal. And so the water of baptism washes the soul from both. Right? In the case of the baby, only original, because that's the only kind that's there. But in an adult who's baptized, original and personal. Washes away whatever is there, as long as we have the right disposition, which we'll talk about later on. Now, this part of the symbolism also has a history. And so in addition to the, we could say the meaning from creation, water washes, there's a meaning here of referring to the Jewish sacramental rite of the ritual immersion, which we could call baptism. And the Jewish word there is tevilah. Tevilah being simply the Hebrew for baptism or immersion. And then the bath, the baptismal font, is called the mikvah, the bath. And so that's part of the Mosaic law, that when one encountered ritual impurity, when one acquired it, one needed to go into this ritual bath to wipe it away. And again, it's the same idea that the water is a natural symbol of cleansing impurity, and here a spiritual kind of impurity. It's just that we speak of it as ritual impurity, because it's not in the Mosaic law, the impurity wasn't moral impurity from sin, but rather a ritual impurity from touching something or having contact with something that was considered to render one ritually impure, such as touching a corpse, touching blood, a woman's menstrual cycle or childbirth. And so there were rites of ritual cleansing so that one could re-enter into divine worship and enter into the temple. And that's still true today in the Jewish community, that the Orthodox Jewish community always will have a mikveh in which one does tevilah to achieve ritual purity after becoming ritually unclean in different ways. Right, so when Jesus instituted baptism, that was a meaning that goes into the meaning of baptism. But again, in the similar way with the change, right? So A to A1, in other words, as Jewish baptism was to ritual impurity, so Christian baptism is to moral impurity. And so as Jewish ritual baptism took away ritual impurity, so our baptism takes away original sin and personal sin. But there's another dimension that is less visible today, in part because of the way we do baptism. So in the early church, as in the synagogue, baptism was immersion. Right? So in Jewish baptism is always by immersion into the mikveh. And that would be a full immersion done naked. And in the early church, likewise, the baptismal fonts weren't quite as big, but you would kneel in them and then be dunked into the baptismal font. Very often the baptismal font had the shape of a cross. That's very beautiful. Or an octagon. The cross, because you're entering into the Christian life, which is the way of the cross, or an octagon, because to represent the eighth day. So Jesus rose on Sunday, Easter Sunday, we could say being the first day of the week in the Jewish calendar, but we think of it as the eighth day, a new beginning, a new creation. So that's why baptismal baptistries and baptismal fonts are generally in the shape of an octagon. And it's also there too a symbolism with regard to Judaism, to recall the eighth day for circumcision. Yeah. All right, so a ritual immersion. And so that ritual immersion, that baptismal immersion has another symbolism that we're less aware of. And that is water has an aspect of death and life. Death by drowning. So think of the great flood, the deluge. And so God used water to wipe out sinful humanity and purify it and bring it to a new birth, a new start with Noah and his family. Right? So too in the baptismal font, there's a death, a drowning of the old man. And here, so the old man drowns and a new man emerges like Noah and his family after the flood. Or a better analogy, closer, is the crossing of the Red Sea. Right? So as the Israelites crossed through the Red Sea, passing through water, they left their pursuers behind. But their pursuers continued to pursue them, Pharaoh and his chariots, and what happens? They got washed away by the water to their death, to never pursue them again. And thus that represents our sin that pursued us until the moment of our baptism, but which got washed away, never to pursue us again. Tragically, though, we can commit new ones, and they continue to pursue us until we go to confession, but that's another sacrament. So water has that aspect of death, death of sinful humanity in the flood, death of Pharaoh and his chariots, death of the old man, and then finally, the last aspect is the paschal mystery, Christ's death. So baptism, St. Paul tells us, is an entrance into Christ's death. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death, right? So baptism is a death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Right? So that's a key meaning of, we could say, the the sacramental sign of baptism, that it's an immersion, that it's a drowning and a death and a coming out of the water as a new birth and a new life. And we tend to miss this today because normally baptism isn't done with immersion, but simply the pouring of water on someone's head, which doesn't represent death. And it doesn't even represent much of washing, but a little bit. But in the early, what's the reason for this? The reason is because we in the West tend to be a very practical people. And baptism by full immersion is messy and wet, and you get everything wet. And so we tend to be, and then in the early church, it also involved nudity, et cetera. And so we've simplified, but in the process of simplifying, we lose some of the symbolism. The Eastern Rite conserves that, right? So in the Eastern Rite, baptism is still done by immersion. There's an amusing rendition of that if you've seen My Big Fat Greek Wedding. There's baptismal scene there, which water everywhere, and full body anointing, etc. So that would be more like the early church. So that's, we could say, the second dimension of the meaning of baptism, death and new life. And they're equally fundamental, right? Jesus chose the sign of baptism to mean both of those symbolisms at the same time, because it's a new birth precisely because it's a washing away of the old. It's a death because it's a washing away of sin. Right? It's a death to sin, but by washing away sin, it makes room for now the divine life to enter, taking away the obstacle, which is sin, and the divine life being sanctifying grace, right, that enters and fills us so that we can rise with Christ. And then the third part being the historical meaning, the reference to Judaism, the reference also to John the Baptist's baptism of repentance, and then to Christ's paschal mystery. So baptism is more complicated than it might have been. In the rite of baptism, that gets signified in the blessing of the water and in a beautiful solemn way at the Easter Vigil, right? When the bishop blesses the baptismal font or the pastor. And in that blessing, the prayer refers to the different symbolism of water. So God, whose spirit in the first moment, so I didn't mention that, the spirit hovering over the water in Genesis chapter 1, first verses. So the very substance of water would even then in creation take to itself the power to sanctify. God, who by the outpouring of the flood foreshadowed regeneration, so that from the mystery of one and the same element of water would come an end to vice and a beginning of virtue. God, who caused the children of Abraham to pass dry shod through the Red Sea, so that the chosen people, set free from slavery to Pharaoh, would prefigure the people of the baptized. And so this is all the meaning of the baptismal font, the historical meaning. And that's why at the Easter Vigil, there are all those readings, right? The reading from Genesis, the reading from Genesis 1, from Genesis 12, I guess, the reading of the crossing the Red Sea, and then various readings from the prophets speaking about the meaning of baptism. Okay. All right, so let's go on to confirmation. So confirmation has likewise a complex symbolism, even more complex than baptism. And it's actually three parts to the sacramental sign. Right, so we could say the sacramental sign in confirmation is a complex sign that involves laying on of hands. And that's what we read about in the Acts of the Apostles. And so in the early church, that was considered to be the most essential part of the sacramental sign. But then very shortly thereafter, or maybe already then, we don't know, there was also the anointing of the forehead with chrism, olive oil. And chrism is olive oil with balsam. Olive oil to represent, again, several things we'll see in a minute, or let's right now. And olive oil represents healing because it was used as a kind of universal ointment. All right, now we use, I don't know, Neosporin or something. But we can see from the parable of the Good Samaritan, right, that the the person who is robbed and left half wounded, the Good Samaritan comes, and what does he do? He pours olive oil on his wounds as a kind of universal medicine. So to heal and to strengthen, to comfort. But it was also used in ancient culture in ways that we don't anymore today. And that was to beautify, right? So you would, at a festival, you would pour oil on your head. I guess we do that some with hair, some cultures with hair lotion. But in the ancient world, much more dramatic, more, I mean, more symbolic cultures in the ancient world. And then it was used also, seems strange to us, in the Olympics. So in sports, in wrestlers would put oil on their body before competing. And so it has that aspect of combat. And that's part of its meaning in confirmation, right? So it's an anointing to signify many things, comforting, strengthening, beautifying, competition, competing here against the enemies of the faith. And then all of that to represent something higher still. And that is because oil stays at the top, right? So if oil is put in water, oil stays on the top. And likewise, when we're anointed, that hovers over us. It can represent something spiritual. And that is an anointing of the Holy Spirit by which the Spirit strengthens, beautifies, comforts, consoles, and divinizes. And that's ultimately what we're signifying. Right? That's the principal meaning of the oil in confirmation, is actually divinization. Now, again, we're not accustomed to think in those terms so much in the West. Right? We use the word maybe sanctification or grace, but it means the same, because sanctifying grace, its very definition, is to share, to participate in the divine nature. And so the anointing in confirmation is signifying the Spirit anointing us with a share of his divine nature, right? And so it's inseparable from the meaning of baptism, because in baptism, that's part of what happens in baptism, right? We rise to new life, and that new life has got to be life in the Spirit. And so confirmation is representing what happens already in baptism. Now, in the early church, they were administered together, right? So that was no problem. The difficulty for us conceptually is that we've separated the two sacraments, and therefore we don't tend to see them as two sides of the same coin, which is how the early church saw them, right? That we're washed clean to be filled. And what do we need to be filled with? The Holy Spirit and his power and sanctification and movement or life. And so just think of St. Paul speaking of the Christian life as life in the Spirit. Or think of Jesus' parable of you chase out the somebody who gets exorcised and the evil spirit is chased away. But if nothing fills me and I'm still empty inside, what's going to happen? The Spirit's going to come back and he'll bite seven others. So when we expel sin, we've got to immediately fill the space with the competition from above here, the Spirit of God. And so baptism and confirmation are very fittingly received together, as happens in the RCIA. Right, so in the RCA, every adult who comes into the, who is unbaptized, gets baptized, confirmed, and then receives communion together. Right, and that's the most fitting way. And likewise, that's done in the Eastern rites. It's only in the Latin rite for children that they become separated. But recent popes, for example, Pope Benedict, spoke about we should think about making confirmation earlier so that it be together with First Communion, even if it's coming after baptism. Anyway, we'll come back to that later on if we have time. Yeah, so here's an example of the meaning of the oil and confirmation that we might not think of. So this is from an early apologist, Theophilus of Antioch in the second century. And so for him, living in ancient Mesopotamian culture, oil had so many meanings that we don't associate it with. What man, when he enters into this life, so I guess babies were anointed with oil, or enters into the gymnasium. What man, when he enters the gymnasium, is not anointed with oil? Right, all of us. But in his culture, that would have been normal. And then he even thinks of an ornament. Oil makes something beautiful. Right? It burn. So just think of maybe a wood sculpture, and you would put oil on it to beautify it. And then even air, he says, is anointed in a certain way by light and wind or spirit. And are you unwilling to be anointed with the oil of God? In fact, we're called Christians, he says, on this account, because we are anointed with the oil of God. Now, again, we've totally lost that reference, but Christian means anointed, right? It's from the Hebrew would be Messiah, from Mashiach being the anointed one. And so to be called a Christian means to be anointed on the model of Christ. And we're anointed on the pattern of Christ through confirmation. All right, we think we become Christians at baptism, and that's true. We do. I don't mean to deny that. But the word Christian really comes from confirmation, in the sense of being anointed with a share of Christ's own anointing by the Holy Spirit. Yes, the liturgy in Antioch, it's the prayer for the consecration of the chrism, says, Father, send your spirit on us and on this oil and consecrate it so that it may be for all who are anointed and marked with it. Holy Myron. Myron is the Greek word for the chrism. Holy, priestly, royal Myron, anointing with gladness, clothing with light, a cloak of salvation, a spiritual gift, right? All of that is what the anointing represents. And that's what we should think of when we think of confirmation. The sanctification of souls and bodies, imperishable happiness, an indelible seal. So we'll talk about that's the character that's imprinted. So as we're anointed, again, the forehead is anointed, but the soul is anointed also. And that anointing lasts for life. Right? That's the indelible seal, which is a buckler of faith, a helmet against the works of the adversary. Beautiful from the Eastern Church. The meaning of the anointing we find in the Old Testament, right? So that'd be this. So first we said creation and culture, and then all of the sacraments have a meaning from history. And so here the history would be the anointing done in the Old Covenant, right? In the Old Testament, of priests, prophets, and kings. We see that the high priest was anointed. Prophet Elisha was anointed by Elijah. But most notably, the kings were anointed, the Davidic king. So Samuel anoints first Saul. And when Samuel anointed him, he received the Spirit and prophesied. And similarly, David. Right? And so the anointing was a sign, but it actually was efficacious. They received the Spirit at that moment so that they could be moved by the Spirit of God to govern wisely. Now, of course, that requires human cooperation. Saul gave that cooperation first, but not withdrew it, as it were, over time. Right? David mostly kept it, right? But there's that episode of Bathsheba and Uriah. The census, etc. And then the kingship in Israel, the anointing was powerful, but it requires a human cooperation. And it's that shows us something about the sacraments. The sacraments are the same way, right? They don't guarantee, they work efficaciously, but they require our cooperation to make them fruitful. And I'll talk more about that in later talks. Right, and so the anointing that we get in confirmation is showing us something very profound by this historical reference. All of the faithful at confirmation become kings like David, become prophets like Aaron, and I'm sorry, priests like Aaron, and prophets like Elijah and Elisha. But so we might look out into the Christian world, they don't seem to show that, at least many. And again, that's often true and tragic, but that's because we're not putting in the our part, right? And that's the cooperation, the faith formation, the disposition that we need to add to that. Okay. Right. So, and the anointing and confirmation is a quote from one of my favorite theologians, Louis Bouillet, who's very attentive to sacramental symbolism and typology. So confirmation, what does it mean? It's a consecration. It's another thing. So if you've ever been at a consecration of an altar, it's a really beautiful ceremony where the bishop takes olive oil, pours it on the altar, smears it over the altar, right, and touches all the parts of the altar with this oil to consecrate the altar. And so when we get anointed in confirmation, that's what's happening to us. We're an altar. We're a king. We're a priest and a prophet getting this consecration, setting us aside for God. And the difference, though, is it's permanent, right? So the altar, all right, it's true. Every consecration lasts until there's a profanation or a sacrament, sacrilege, or something is deconsecrated. But an altar could have that happen to it. But we have this consecration permanently. It's true, we can render it unfruitful, as I mentioned, tragically, but we still are consecrated. And that makes us a receptacle, a vessel, which takes to itself forever the fragrance, right? So then when we get confirmed, or when a priest gets ordained, he gets some of that chrism on his hands to signify the power of his hands to consecrate. And that smells beautiful, right? And so if and even in baptism, we also put some of that on the baby's head. And so the baby has this beautiful smell for some time. But we should think that fragrance, which is signifying the fragrance of Christ, that's an indelible fragrance, at least in power, as long as we stay in a state of grace. Okay. And then the third part of the symbolism of confirmation is the sign of the cross. And so that oil is traced in the sign of a cross, marking us with the mystery of Christ's passion. And so that's a key part, again, showing us what the Christian life is. We're getting anointed, yes, as kings, but kings on the model of Christ, not on the model simply of David or Nero or Nebuchadnezzar. So Christ's kingship, which is service and laying down one's life. And so that's what's getting traced on our forehead. And then there's a beautiful history to that as well in the Old Covenant. And that is the prophet Ezekiel had a prophetic vision of an angel marking all of those who were faithful in Jerusalem with a tau, tau being the last letter of the Hebrew language, T, but like our T, it had a form like that of a cross, especially in the earlier Hebrew script. And so Ezekiel saw people be marked in effect with the sign of a cross on their foreheads for all of those who wept over the iniquities done in Jerusalem and therefore yearned for redemption. And so that's, again, a beautiful type of what happens in confirmation. And so in confirmation, we're marked as mourners who mourn over sin, who therefore commit themselves to a battle, right? The good combat of the faith. Okay, let's go on to the Eucharist. So in the Eucharist, the matter here is bread and wine. And here too, there's an obvious meaning to that, which I don't think anybody should miss, but then there's a more subtle meaning, which probably most do miss. So the obvious meaning is nourishment, right? So the bread nourishes, the wine nourishes, the wine also inebriates. And therefore, in the Eucharist, there's a nourishment that's spiritual, right? Taking on Christ's life, and an inebriation that's spiritual, right? That joy in the spirit, that's part of the Christian life. So that's the obvious meaning of it. But then there's a no less significant meaning, which is Christ's body and blood. And so Jesus chose a solid bread to signify his body, which it becomes through his own words said by the minister, this is my body. And then wine, especially if it's red wine, to signify blood. Right? And so again, that works better, if the color matches, red wine, And so Jesus chose the wine also for that reason. And for this reason also, he chose two matters and not just one. Because you might think, why not just bread? Why do you need the wine also? Because if he just had bread, it would only represent his body. But he wanted to represent his death, right? Because this is the second dimension, this salvation history dimension. He wanted the Eucharist to be a participation in his whole Paschal mystery. And that is his passion, death, and resurrection. And so the passion and death is represented in a way similar to what happened to all of the Paschal lambs, right? So when you brought a Paschal lamb to the temple, you cut its neck. And the priest that was there with a basin to receive the blood from the Paschal lamb. And so in the separation of the blood from the body, you brought about the immolation of the victim and the death of the victim. And so Jesus on the cross, in stages, right, even before the cross, he was started with his sweating blood in Gethsemane, and then with his flagellation, and the crowning with thorns, and then the nailing to the cross. His blood gradually got separated from his body, and in final, the culmination was when he already died, his side being pierced, and the blood and water coming out. And so in his passion and death, his blood was separated from his body. And that's what's represented by the dual consecration of body and blood, bread and wine. And that's why they're consecrated separately, the wine after the bread, in other words, to indicate his blood being separated from his body on the altar. And that's what realizes the sacrifice at the Eucharist. That's why every Mass is a sacrifice, because it's making present sacramentally Christ's immolation that happened physically 2,000 years ago. Right? And so it's crucial to the Mass that there be both species. And that's why in the Code of Canon Law, it says that even under the most dire circumstances, say you're in a concentration camp or in a prison, if all you have is bread or all you have is wine, you can't see the Eucharist. Both species have to be present, because even though he would be really present if you just consecrated one species, and thus we would have Christ present on the altar, we wouldn't have his sacrifice represented, which is the body and blood separated sacramentally on the altar. Now, what we actually receive in Holy Communion is the resurrected Jesus, because we're receiving him as he is today. And he's risen 2,000 years ago, never to separate again. And so in reality, his body and blood are joined ever since Easter Sunday, 2,000 years ago. So when we receive, that's why it doesn't matter that the faithful receive in one species or two, because the whole of them is present under either one. But the symbolism is necessary to sacramentally represent his passion, because the law of the sacraments, we've said, is that they do what they represent. And so if it doesn't represent his immolation, it doesn't do it. It wouldn't make his sacrifice present, and therefore it wouldn't fulfill our Sunday Mass obligation of offering that sacrifice with him, the same sacrifice he offered 2,000 years ago, the same Jesus being offered under sacramental signs. All right, so that's the reason. So that's, we could say, the secondary, no less important symbolism of bread and wine, to represent body and blood and the separation and to bring about his sacramental immolation. All right, so that's two meanings, but there's a third. And the third meaning is that of unity, ecclesial communion, because that's its purpose. The purpose of the Eucharist is to make us one, to make us, and that's why we call it communion, Holy Communion, because it's a union with Christ first, right? And so we could say it's uniting us with him by receiving his body and blood into our bodies. So making a bodily union with Christ. And this is what's so tragic right now in this time of the pandemic, when we can't, right? All the faithful are being asked to make spiritual communions, which is great, but we're not receiving his body into our bodies. That's only happens in a sacramental communion. But what's the purpose of that? Jesus wants to be received into our body with his body to build a deeper communion with us that is also spiritual and that lasts. the bodily communion lasts only 10 minutes, right? Because right after we receive him, our stomach works to digest and break down that bread and that wine. And after 10 minutes, I don't have his body and blood in me anymore. But he wants that 10-minute presence so as to build something spiritual, and that is spiritual communion with him, but also with all the others who receive him, right? Because we're members of the body, we receive our head, that, and together with our head, we get cemented into one with all of our brothers and sisters in Christ, right? So that's the profound meaning of, or not just meaning, but effect of Holy Communion. That's why we receive communion principally, to build up the church in communion, the communion of charity above all, right? The communion of faith, hope, and charity with Christ and with one another. And so we could say that the final effect of the Eucharist is the mystical body, communion in the mystical body. And therefore, for this reason also, Jesus chose bread and wine. And that is, and that is simply the fact that in making bread, you take many, many grains, right? Grind them, and you make one loaf. So from the many grains and stalks, you get one new thing. And that's a symbol of what happens through receiving Holy Communion. We get made into one loaf, the whole church. Now, tragically, we can pose obstacles to this, right? And that's sin, pride, division, etc., partisanship. But that's its effect if we don't block it. And similar in the wine, right? So wine is made from many, many grapes, but it makes one drink, one chalice, which is inseparable, right? I can't see anymore which came from which grape. And so that too shows us the effect of communion if we let it do its work, if we don't block it, to weld us into one in the church, right? And again, how important this is and how much we are impotent to bring this about ourselves without Christ's aid, right? So those would be the three aspects of the symbolism of the bread and the wine. Let's go on to anointing of the sick. I'm sorry, I'm running over time here. Try and draw this to close. So in the anointing of the sick, it's easier because it's the olive oil here has the meaning of that kind of salve or ointment that heals, right? So exactly the meaning it has in the parable of the Good Samaritan. Right? And so the sick get anointed, but again, what's the purpose of that? To show healing, but what kind of healing? It's true, sometimes it can bring about a physical healing, but that's not its universal purpose, right? It's a sacrament, not because it sometimes brings physical healing, but because it further heals us from sin, right? So that's the meaning of the anointing. In anointing of the sick, a further remedy, and thus it presupposes the more obvious remedy of confession and the sacrament of penance. So in the right course of things, you should receive the sacrament of penance before anointing of the sick, if possible. And sometimes this isn't always emphasized enough in anointing services. But anyway, it's presupposing that sins have already been presented in penance, but we still have wounds. So that's the point. After a good confession, am I so healed from sin that I don't bear its scars, wounds, sinful attitudes, etc.? Tragically, no. And so we need a further remedy, especially in the case of serious illness, when we're preparing for the more proximate meeting with Jesus in our particular judgment. And so it's a further remedy against sin in the light of our final encounter. But at the same time, so that would be the principal meaning. But there's another meaning as well. We said that olive oil consecrates. And so that's a secondary meaning here. It's consecrating our illness. It's really beautiful. So in the Christian life, there's this paradox that when we're weak physically, we become strong spiritually. And this has to do with the last shall be first and the first last. Right? So in our physical life, yeah, the first would be those, you know, who are healthy, win the Olympics, the gold medal. But so often in the Christian life, handicaps, sickness, illness, those are privileged moments of grace, because then we take the last place, as it were, in the natural order, so as to be put into the first in the spiritual order. And so we see that very often conversion happens that way. Conversion will happen when we encounter an illness, a tragedy, a cross. And this is the, and one of the tragedies of so much of our modern life is that we don't recognize this in the elderly, in the handicapped, in the those who suffer, that they're actually spiritual powerhouses because they have this thing that they can offer, which is the most precious thing to offer, and that is our suffering. Of all the things that we can offer, suffering is the hardest to offer, right? Because we don't want it. But it's what's most pleasing because it involves giving more of ourself. It touches us so much more. And so what Jesus is doing in anointing the sick is consecrating that illness so as to unleash its redemptive power. So we should think of anointing the sick as a sacrament of consecration of that illness. And that's why you only do it once in a given illness, right? Because you're consecrated. You don't need to receive it again the next week and the week after, etc., because your illness is already consecrated. It's true, you can receive it again if it becomes significantly more grave, and so it's like another illness. But in one given illness, once is enough. Okay. And then finally, laying on of hands in ordination. And I think we've already explained that. It's a natural sign of the transmission of power and headship, right? And so here the salvation history aspect of that is we see that in the Old Covenant that Moses lays his hands on Joshua, right, to pass his leadership over Israel to Joshua. And then there was a similar Joshua, there was a laying on of hands of the 72 who received a part of that spirit. And so this would be, and in even in the synagogue for a time at the time of Jesus, there was a laying on of hands to ordain rabbis. I mean, so it was a natural symbolism of that passing on of headship. And then finally, the difficult sacraments, penance and matrimony. We said that in penance, the essential sign is invisible. That's it, because it's an act of the penitent, and that's contrition. But we express it, right? And so that's why we say our act of contrition sensibly, because sacraments involve sensible manifestation. And it's for the same reason that we wish maybe we didn't have to do it, but that's why we sensibly manifest our sins by confessing them audibly to the priest, right? So that we can make this matter of the sacrament sensible and audible and put it forward to the minister who represents Christ so that he can heal it and forgive it. And so it's fitting that penance have this matter that's made sensible in the confession. Yeah. So the Council of Florence defined this. It speaks of it as quasi-matter, quasi just simply because it's not physical. And it's three parts, right? So the matter in the sacrament of confession is our contrition. That's the most important, can't ever be lacking. So confession is never valid if I don't have contrition. And then oral confession, and again, that could sometimes be lacking, right? If a person is mute, if a person is dying, if it's a general confession in the case of, you know, an airplane going down or something. And then the third part is the satisfaction, and that's the penance that the priest gives us to do. And it might be three Hail Marys, a rosary, something along those lines. And then the form is the words of absolution, I absolve you. And then matrimony, here the interesting thing is the ministers are the spouses. And they're administering to one another through saying the words of matrimonial consent, their marriage vows. Right? That's, and so the marriage vow is both matter and form, we could say. Okay. And so in marriage, each spouse is minister to the other and gives the matter to the other. And we could say that the matter being the vow and then the acceptance of the other's gift is the form. And so that's a beautiful representation of the mutual nature of marriage, by each one's gift to the other, making this bond and union. And so I've gone into overtime, I'll end it here. So Jesus has beautifully instituted the sacraments, combining nature, history, and salvation history and culture, so as to represent what he wants to give us through them. All right, so let's take a break here, and then questions. So you can write out your questions in the chat feature, or if you have trouble with that, just ask it orally. So our first question is, how is the consummation of a marriage related to the sacrament? Yeah, that's a great question. So the general principle in theology is that consent makes marriage. So marriage is made essentially not by consummation, but by consent, which implies consummation, right? Because you're consenting to the self-gift of your body to your spouse and vice versa. It's the consent that makes the marriage. But it is true that obviously the consummation physically represents the meaning of marriage. And so that too being the act of the spouses to consummate in the sense of represent fully through a bodily union what the marriage means, which is a mutual self-gift of one's whole life to the other that is potentially fruitful. And so that now it is also true that in the New Covenant, there is a distinction between us. The technical terms are ratum and consummatum, that's the Latin terms. So if a marriage is both sacramental and consummated, there's no power that can dissolve it. In other words, it can't, even the Holy Father can't dissolve it. And so consummation does add that final touch of indissolubility by representing and what the meaning of that mutual self-gift is. But we still want to say that a marriage in which that didn't happen, like that between Mary and Joseph, was still valid and was still a marriage because there was a total self-gift and it was made by the mutual the mutual consent of Mary and Joseph. Okay, another question. Thomas Aquinas mentions the matter of holy orders as the handing of the chalice and the paten to the ordinand. Is this correct? That's exactly right. And so that still is done in the Latin rite. But that's something that's proper to the Latin rite that's not present in the Eastern rites. So in the Latin rite ordination, if you've been to an ordination, in the ordination, yes, there's the laying on of hands, and we say that's the essential part today. And then the prayer of the bishop who expresses the meaning, which is the form. But there's also a giving of the paten and the chalice to signify that a priest is being ordained to sacrifice, right? To offer the sacrifice of the Mass. So that's what that's signifying. And apparently in the time of St. Thomas, he viewed that as the essential matter. And so that's in his works. When he asks, what is the matter of the Sacrament of Holy Orders? It's the passing over of the handing over of the chalice and the paten. Now there's a problem though. That can't be the universally necessary matter if that's not present in the Eastern Rites, because the Eastern Rites have valid holy orders, but they don't do that. So it's impossible to think that that is so essential that it can't ever be lacking. In other words, it can't be the essential nucleus instituted by Jesus Christ. And the Acts of the Apostles don't show that, right? The Acts of the Apostles just show laying out of hands. Actually, they don't show that directly. We find that in the letter of St. Paul. Laying on his hands on Timothy and Titus, and to see Timothy in particular. And so that's how we see that and what was done in the time of the New Testament. So, but here to make it more difficult, the Council of Florence In its decree to the Armenians, it took a work of St. Thomas and basically explained that to the Armenians as a conciliar magisterial document. And it says that the matter for the sacrament of holy orders is the handing over of the chalice and the paten. All right, so what do we make about that? That's a council, a valid council, Council of Florence. Did it make a mistake? Now, it's not totally impossible, because a council isn't infallible unless it wants to be. It has to have the intention of teaching something infallibly. And the Council of Florence clearly had that intention in some things, but not in others. Just as Vatican II didn't have that intention, except in certain very restricted places. And so I think one way to answer this is the Council of Florence was simply intending to give a kind of catechesis drawing from a work of Thomas Aquinas to the Armenians, but not intending to define. And I think that's true. But there's another way to analyze it as well. And that is that something can be necessary for validity in a particular rite at a particular time and still change, as long as that's something added by the church. I think I explained this a little bit last time when we spoke about Jesus instituting the sacraments. When Jesus instituted the sacraments, he instituted the essential aspect of the sacrament, but he left certain things to his church to further define. And that would be aspects of the matter and form. So for example, the prayers of the form are not given by Jesus, except in the case of the Eucharist. But even there, we've got four different accounts that don't agree exactly. So there's a certain flexibility that the church has. And we see this also with regard to confirmation, that it seems in the Acts of the Apostles, just laying on of hands, but then shortly thereafter, in the second century, we get anointed with olive oil. And so the church has that power to add something and can require what it adds as necessary for validity, and then can subtract it at a later time. So we can think that at the time of the Council of Florence, the passing on of the chalice and the paten might have been necessary matter in the Middle Ages, in the Latin Rite only, but not in the Eastern Rite. And so that's also could be what they mean by saying the matter of the sacrament, meaning in the Latin Rite, is this. Pius XII came back to this in 1947, and he wrote an apostolic constitution declaring them with his full authority that if that was the case, it is no longer. And so now what's necessary for validity in the sacrament of holy orders is not the passing on of the chalice, but only the laying on of hands and the words of the essential words of the prayer said by the bishop. Right? And so that's the way we should think about it. Great question. But again, the reason why St. Thomas liked it is because it did symbolize very clearly that a priest is ordained to offer the sacrifice of the Mass, the Eucharist. Great question. So here's a question from Bob. A few years ago, the altar at St. Monica's was desecrated through an act of vandalism. After reconstructing the altar, was it necessary to anoint it again? I don't know what actually happened because I didn't follow through on that. I heard about that, but the answer would be yes, I would think. You would want to reconsecrate it, the bishop, even in a renovation. So yeah, obviously in a renovation, if you put in a new altar, you'll reconsecrate it. So we did that at the chapel at Kenrick Seminary, where I teach. So we did a renovation. There was a new altar built. And so Archbishop Carlson came out there and did this ceremony of pouring the olive oil, the chrism, I mean, just like confirmation, but with large quantity, smearing it on the altar. It was really beautiful to see that. Another question from Juan. Why is there necessary dispensation from a Catholic to marry a Protestant? I mean, related to the sacrament. That's a good question, because you might think, all right, if both are baptized, you would need, and so the way it works is marriage, because it pre-existed Christ, right, because it existed from the beginning, there can be a natural matrimony. So for example, my wife and I, Marcia and I, were married as unbaptized atheist Jews. And so what happened was we were both baptized at the same moment together with our baby. And at the very moment of being baptized, our marriage got elevated because it got inserted into the covenant. And so by the very fact of being baptized together, it became a sacrament, the new covenant sacrament of matrimony. And that would happen. Likewise, even if the same thing would happen in a Protestant baptism, right? So if you had something, the same case, by being baptized, even if not in the Catholic Church, it would elevate it. And so the mixed marriage would become sacramental of itself. But the reason why a dispensation is necessary is simply because it's not a good thing in and of itself, because marriage thrives when there's unity also of faith in its fullness. But what obviously a dispensation can be given if one can make up for some of the for that natural loss of unity in other ways. So that's the reason for the necessity of a dispensation. It's much more necessary if a baptized person marries an unbaptized person, in which case the marriage isn't sacramental. Right? In order to be sacramental, both have to be baptized. Yeah, great question. Another one from Bob. You said that anointing of the sick presupposes confession. All right, not necessarily, right? Just in the logically, we could say. So not for validity. Suppose that someone is very ill and unable to confess. They're unconscious. How does that impact the graces from the anointing of the sick? Great question. Thanks for asking that. I should have made that clear. So in a case like that, the anointing will supply the effect that would have been given by confession. But it presupposes that the person before they became unconscious had contrition habitually. Because sins are never forgiven without contrition. Right? So we have to be contrite. But it's possible to be habitually contrite. In fact, so this is what we ought to, so if we're ever aware doing examination of conscience that we have a mortal sin on our conscience, then we should immediately, then and there, first thing we do, is make an act of perfect contrition. An act of perfect contrition being sorry that we've sinned and out of love for God and resolving to avoid it in the future. And if we do that, that anticipates, and if we intend to go to confession when we can, that anticipates the effect of confession, in which case we'd already be in a state of grace. And so if that were the case, somebody then fell unconscious and anointing the sick wouldn't be forgiving their sin because their sin was already forgiven. What anointing would be doing would be increasing their grace. Now, let's suppose somebody habitually had contrition for sin, but without perfect contrition, only imperfect contrition. What's that? That's when we're sorry that we've sinned because reasonably we don't want to go to hell for all eternity. And so we're sorry that we've caused this consequence for ourselves, and we ask for God's forgiveness only for that reason. That's called imperfect contrition. And if we resolve to break with that sin because we don't want to go to hell, that's not enough to anticipate the effect of the sacrament of penance. But if we then become unconscious, get anointed, that is enough. That sin will be forgiven, and God will infuse his grace and actually infuse his charity so that he gives us perfect contrition if we were to revive and recover, right? So in that case, the anointing of the sick is actually necessary for salvation for such a person who only has imperfect contrition, hasn't been to confession, falls unconscious. He needs that priest, better get to that house and anoint him. But in the case of the person who already had perfect contrition, if the priest doesn't get there and he already passes away, he'll... Now, what should we think about this? I think a lot of people think that perfect contrition is very difficult and that it's only, rare perfect people like St. Francis of Assisi who would have perfect contrition. That's a mistake. Perfect contrition means that you are sorry that you've sinned because you recognize that God loves you and you feel bad because you're his son and you've offended him and let him down. That's reasonable. I mean, it's not, none of us can do that by ourselves. All of us need grace to do that. But that grace is available to all, and everyone can do that. And so we should think that we can do that, and thus we shouldn't be too worried about those for whom, who died. Because in these days, I mean, there are people dying, and it can be very difficult for a priest to get to them. But we shouldn't, so we shouldn't fear for, even though it's a great ministry for priests to anoint the dying, we should have hope that an act of perfect contrition can supply that effect. Right, if penance couldn't. In a case like that, though, suppose the person then recovers. So let's say you had the person who couldn't go to confession, falls unconscious, and this sometimes happens, receives anointing of the sick. So our current vicar general, Monsignor Staley, told me this story. It was, he got a sick call on his birthday. And so he was feeling, he had all these plans, you know, to do something on his birthday, I think play golf or something. So instead of playing golf, he had to go to the sick person, their nursing home, and he was in a coma. So he anoints him. And right after the anointing, the man sat up and said, "Let's go, I'm going home." And so every once in a while, the sacrament of anointing does have that effect of restoring physical health, if that's beneficial for our spiritual life. Right? God will give that effect if we need it, in which case that person would still have to go to confession and confess the sins that anointing has already forgiven. It's not, the reason why we have to do that is not because, it's the same thing if we forget a sin, right? So if we go make a good confession and we forgot a mortal sin, then it got forgiven together with all the others. We're in a state of grace. But in our next confession, we're supposed to mention it. Right? And the same thing would be true here. And it's also true if you get general absolution, then you still have to say those sins in your next confession, even though they all got forgiven. It's simply, it's a matter of canon law, not of forgiveness. Okay, another question. If I understood you correctly, there's a defect in both the matter and the intention of Anglican orders. Is that correct? Not in the matter. So they're doing the right matter, laying on of hands. But what happened was from 15, I forget when, it middle of the 16th century to the middle of the 17th century, the ordination ritual took out any reference to ordaining someone to be a priest to offer sacrifice. And so for 100 years, the ordination ritual was defective in its form, even though it was correct in its matter, the matter being the laying on of hands, but the form being the prayer said by the bishop. After the middle of the 17th century, they added in some extra words to signify ordination for the service of the priesthood. But in that 100-year period, everyone who received it invalidly, and thus apostolic succession was lost over that 100-year period. And so even though they corrected the ordination rite, and now they have proper both matter and form, they've lost apostolic succession. That's how they lost holy orders. So even though today they might have the right both matter and form, they would, what they're missing is it has to be a bishop who has apostolic succession, who ordains. Okay. Any other questions? Angie?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, I have a question. When you were talking about baptism, you said that, okay, that the baptism is like the washing away of sin. And then you said you made an analogy to a gospel reading where the house was cleaned and then, I forgot, the seven spirits. Would you say that, like, baptism washes away the sin and creates the void, and then the sacrament of confirmation fills that void with the Holy Spirit?
I spoke imprecisely. And the way we should think about this is that baptism does both. Right? So baptism both washes away from sin and gives the Spirit, but its sacramental sign doesn't express that the way confirmation does. So that's why there's also an anointing given in baptism. So given the Western practice of separating the two sacraments, right, we get baptized as babies and we get confirmed as teenagers, generally. And so the two sacraments are separated. And so to signify that baptism does both things, it both washes away sin and gives the Spirit.
Yes.
There's an anointing also given in baptism. It's not part of the essential sign of baptism, but it's simply signifying that that's what's also happening. So, yeah, so sorry about the
No, that's okay.
Education. Yeah, so because we should think that baptism does both, but confirmation has that principal purpose. That's its proper effect, is to give the Spirit. And that's why I think that the Eastern practice of receiving confirmation together with baptism is especially fitting.
Yes, I was thinking the same thing. Yes, I was thinking exactly that. And I have another question about the laying on of hands. I remember reading in the Old Testament that before the animals were sacrificed, the priest at the door of the temple had to lay his hands on the animal. Do you think there's any connection there, or why do you think the priest had to lay his hands on the animal before it was sacrificed?
Right, so that's representing, again, so the laying on of hands represents transfer. And so in the rite of the scapegoat, right, there's a laying on of hands, but here meaning an opposite transfer, right? Not a transfer of headship, but a transfer of sin.
Okay.
So that's what's being signified there. In the case of sacrifice in general, it could be that, yes, it's a laying on of sin, but also in some way that the sacrifice is representing a kind of headship, because every sacrifice, Paschal Lamb, is representing Christ, the victim. So I don't know. I'd have to look into that more.
Yeah. And I have one other question. When you talked about the Jewish ritual bath in the Old Testament, I think you said mikvah.
Mm-hmm.
Did that have to be connected to the ground, or did it not have to be connected? Because John the Baptist was in a river, so
right.
I was just wondering, did it have to be connected to the earth?
No, I don't think so. I mean, your typical mikvah is sure a pool, but like a baptismal font, but bigger. But John the Baptist clearly used the River Jordan as the best kind of baptismal water, because it's living, running water. I don't know the history of Jewish thought on that. But our earliest Christian text about baptism is the Didache from the end of the first century. And in the Didache, it explains how to baptize. And then it tells, what should you use? You want to use living water if possible. That's the best. In other words, running water like the River Jordan.
Uh-huh.
If that's not possible, you can use a pool of cool water. But if you only have warm water, you can use that too. And if all you have is a little water to pour, that's okay too. So it gives a kind of series of preferential ways of expressing the symbolism, but all of them are equally valid.
And I also thought about how the sacraments, they're for the body, but ultimately they're for the soul, because after death, they can't be administered anymore.
Even though they
touch the body, they're ultimately for the soul, because the soul has to be present in order for them to be administered.
Yeah, excellent. Because it's what happens to the body is representing what's happening to the soul. And all of the sacraments are about giving grace. And grace can't, right? Grace is received properly by the soul, even though it has effects on the body, but not directly. Through all the sacraments.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Could I ask a question?
Sure, Karen.
Just going back to perfect contrition, I think it's so, I mean, I understand what you're saying, but I think it's really hard to think that, to think that the feelings have to be involved. In other words, because my son said, well, I could never have perfect nutrition. I'd never be sorry enough.
And that's not what it means.
So, and I know that. So if you could just comment a little bit more on how perfect contrition does not involve our feelings.
Great question. So perhaps it's an unfortunate term, but we're stuck with it. So I think the first reason why it's unfortunate is because people hear it meaning an act of contrition that's perfect, meaning I feel it perfectly.
Right.
And it doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that I feel sorrow. That would be great if that happens, but that's not necessary because that's not completely under our control. We don't have perfect control over our emotions, obviously. That's part of original sin, is that we don't have that perfect control over emotions. But what we do have control over is our will, and that's what we want. And that's so an act of contrition is essentially an act of the will. And it means that my will is sorry. And the will works through knowledge. And in this, right? And so the will depends on what I know and believe. And so knowing and believing that sin is the death of my soul and brings about hell, that's why I would make an act of imperfect contrition. Yeah. But knowing that God is my Father who loves me, that's the reason for my being sorry. Again, in my will, even if I don't feel it, physically, in other words, I'm not crying. As long as I know that God is my Father, that's the key thing. And therefore, I know that I'm sorry. And therefore, the principal thing in contrition is actually the resolve, right? I'm so sorry that I resolve to break it. That's where it tells us that we're lying, right? Because I might say, oh, I'm sorry, but I'm going to do it again tomorrow.
Yes.
If I say that, then I don't have contrition.
So it's the knowledge of some that was, because I want to be able to get it in my own head and also share with my son that it's the knowledge of that we have sin and that we really don't want to offend our Father.
Right.
God the Father.
Right. So if I resolve to not to sin and I know that God is offended and I love him, then it's perfect contrition. Even if I'm also, so perfect contrition doesn't mean that that's my only motive. Because it's reasonable also not to want to go to hell.
Yes.
And so it's perfectly reasonable to have both motives at the same time. And that's still perfect contrition.
But it's our intellect and our will.
Right, right. And not our feeling, which is great. We can ask for feelings, but we shouldn't be troubled by that.
Yes. And,
yeah.
Okay.
Easier thanks. Said than done. Great. Well, thank you all for so many great questions. Happy Mother's Day again. Sorry to hope nobody missed family celebrations. I'm sure you wouldn't for coming to this. But and hopefully you'll have a good one, although it's harder in this time of social distancing. So our next talk will be in 2 weeks, May 24th, on the subject and the minister. So that's the other two parts of the sacramental sign. And we'll take on some of the more controversial questions. Why do priests have to be men? And why marriage requires, well, that's easier, a man and a woman, and it can't be two men or two women. Among other questions, we'll also look at the intention that's necessary. Great. All right, so have a wonderful 2 weeks. And in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.